Good afternoon, and welcome to the Rotary Club of Madison. Woo! I'm Teresa Holmes, and I'm so excited to start my year as your president. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. As we announced a few months ago, we have offered members an opportunity to sponsor our luncheon during this new Rotary year. We got this idea from some of the other large Rotary clubs, and the sponsorship will help with the cost of the luncheons. We know, as we've started the meeting, there are people who are in the line still, and they're gonna just join us right into the room. But Melanie Raining is helping us secure those sponsorships each week, and she has already filled out the first quarter. I wanted to start us out by serving as your first sponsor. So I am leading the way by sponsoring my company, Exponential Endeavors, who is providing the sponsorship for today's luncheon. You will hear more from Melanie next week with more details about how you can sponsor a future meeting. All right, opening music. Let's start with our opening music. Casey Okers will lead us in the singing of This Land Is Your Land, and with Elaine Mitchler on piano. And then following that, Casey will lead us in the singing of Old MacDonald Had a Farm.
This land is your land. This land is your land. This land is my land. From California to the New York Island, to the Redwood Forest, to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me. As I was walking that ribbon of highway, I saw above me an endless skyway. I saw below me a golden valley. This land was made for you and me. This land is your land. This land is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me.
Thank you. And now, in honor of National Cow Appreciation Day, we will sing Old MacDonald Had a Farm. If you would please take a moment to look at the table tent on your table, we are going to divide up into the cows. So raise your hand if you're a cow. And what does the cow say? All right, and who are the pigs? And what do the pigs say? All right, and the next is the sheep. Who are the sheep? And what do the sheep say? Great, and who are the ducks? And what does the duck say? All right, so when it's your turn, sing out loud and sing out proud. Let's get started. Take it away, Elaine. Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O. And on his farm he had some cows, E-I-E-I-O. With a... Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O. Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O. And on his farm he had some pigs, E-I-E-I-O. With a... Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O. Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O. And on his farm he had some sheep, E-I-E-I-O. With a ba-ba here and ba-ba there, here, ba, there, ba, everywhere, ba, ba. Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O. Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O. And on his farm he had some ducks, E-I-E-I-O with a
strong ducks.
Old MacDonald had a farm. E-I-E-I-O.
I think we had some strong ducks in the room, right? Go Ducks! All right, thank you, Casey and Elaine. Wow. All right, Donna Moreland is going to introduce today's guest. Thank you, Donna.
Thank you, President Holmes. First of all, Melanie Ramey. Where are you, Melanie? Oh, your badge. I have your badge. I'll bring it to you when I'm done. I'll bring it to you. I have the pleasure of introducing our visitors today. When I call your name, please stand. Please hold your applause till all. Please stand. Okay. Juliet Page, guest of Larry Hands. Juliet? Kelly McBride, guest of Valerie Casamias. Sarah Gottluski, she had not come when I was out there, so she may not be here. Mary Alice Wimmer, guest of Bill White. And Margaret Murphy, a former member visiting us today. Remain standing. Please join me in recognizing our visitors today.
Thank you. Thank you, Donna. Yes, it seems like we've been on a break around here, huh? All right, new members. We start off the new year with a new member introduction. Will Leticia Nelson? Please stand with her sponsor, Becky Steinhoff. And I'm also a sponsor for Leticia. Leticia has been loaned the classification of community services and is the CEO of the Goodman Community Center. Many of you will recall that she spoke to our club recently about her role at the Goodman Community Center. Born in Milwaukee, she now lives on Acker Parkway in DeForest with her husband, Henry. She holds a bachelor's degree in business from St. Martin's College. Leticia is an avid Girl Scouts volunteer, and she enjoys watching historical movies. Please join me, Rotarians, in welcoming Leticia into our club. The symposium, and he has an announcement.
Well, thank you, President Teresa. Excuse me. How exciting is that, right? That's my, and your lead-in music choice? That was fantastic. I'm so excited because this is my first time back in 15 months. It is great to see everybody. That's not why I was asked to speak, though, so I should probably cut to the chase. As many of you know, and for our new members in particular, welcome, by the way. For over 20 years, our downtown Madison Rotary Club has been, hosting an annual ethics symposium in the spring. It's comprised of a little over 200 high school juniors from around Dane County. This past year, though, we weren't able to host the event, no thanks to COVID. But we did take some time, the committee, to create two very short promotional videos. The first video was created for participating high schools as a way for the school representative to better understand our event and hopefully encourage them to have some of their students apply and register for our symposium. Let's take a look at this first video. It's about a minute long.
For over 20 years, the Rotary Club of Madison has conducted its annual day-long ethics symposium for high school juniors. Ethical education engages students with issues and problems facing society today. The symposium empowers critical thinking, discussion, and debate. Each year during the 5.5-hour, highly interactive event, 200 students learn a framework for ethical decision-making and meet in small groups that include their peers from across Dane County. This cross-section of their community ensures that these juniors will encounter perspectives and experiences differing from their own. The symposium is free to students and funded by a grant from the Madison Rotary Foundation. There are seats waiting for your students now. If you'd like to learn more or register your school, contact the Rotary Club of Madison today.
So as you can see, that first video is short, it's to the point, and we will be providing it to the Dane County High Schools this fall and sending it their way. The next video, the second of two, isn't quite a minute in length, and this one is important for all of you, our club members. Let's take a quick look, Jane.
As you know, for over 20 years, we've conducted our signature program, the Rotary Ethics Symposium. Ethical education engages students with issues and problems facing society today. The symposium empowers critical thinking, discussion, and debate. Because this program is free to students, volunteer support is crucial to its sustainability. There are a variety of ways you can help keep the Rotary Ethics Symposium continuing to serve our community. Multi-year volunteering is encouraged. Help us all to continue to connect, grow, and serve. To learn more or volunteer, contact the Rotary office today.
All right. Well, I am delighted to share that we have a firm date for our return of in-person ethics symposium. It is scheduled for Friday, February 4th at Monona Terrace. We'll have over 200 students again attending, and we will need over 50 volunteers from the club during the half-day long event to make it a success again. We'll begin our planning meetings in September, and we welcome you to be a part of the planning committee. Or if you just want to be a volunteer that day and not serve on the committee, that is absolutely fine as well. You can contact the office to let us know if you'd like to help out. Before I return the stage, I'd like to thank Paul Ranola of Requisite Video for our fantastic videos, and also thank Wayne Glowack, who created the scripts that were used for the videos. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike. Serving on the Ethics Symposium Committee has been one of my Rotary bests. So, yeah, I'll be looking forward to being there. All right, we have birthdays to celebrate with a bit of humor or wisdom that complements our Rotary mission. We also encourage members to make an age-appropriate gift to the Madison Rotary Foundation, rounded up to $100 of our club's, or for our club's, Synergy Scholarship Fund. Are you guys ready? July 12th. If you are in the room, Rotarian, please stand. July 12th. Jeff Tubbs. July 13th, Cheryl DeMars. July 14th, Dave Billing. July 14th, Jeremiah Robinson. He's a new member. July 16th, Joe Lanis. July 17th, Michael MMoCA. July 17th, Ward Pike. July 17th, John Sims. None of our board. Oh, there we go. We've got a solo birthday celebrant in the room. Thanks to our celebrants for their contributions to the Madison Rotary Foundation. Please join me in wishing them a happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Rotarians. Happy birthday to you.
All right. We have many members in the news items to cover today, but first I want to give our condolences to Mark Clear, whose mom... Members in the news, Masood Akhtar was quoted in an article titled Continuing Educational Institute, launching his new We Are Many United Against Hate. Congratulations to Deb Archer, who has recently been included or inducted into the Destination International's Hall of Fame. Congratulations to Lynn Brady, who recently retired as CEO of Journey Mental Health. Londa Dewey and Sandy Morales were pictured and quoted in In Business Magazine's featured article on executive vision. Peter Gray was pictured and interviewed about the Boys and Girls Club, which hosted a 50-mile walk as part of its annual campaign. Jason Ilstrup was quoted in an article about creating a guide to making Madison downtown more outdoors and more outdoors events and festivals. Oscar Morales was pictured and quoted in the Isthmus Word of Mouth on an article about the Moriela soccer team. Anna Moffitt was quoted in an article about Miramont Behavioral Health in the Wisconsin State Journal. Congratulations to Susan Smith, who has been recently joined the Wisconsin State Journal's editorial board. Congratulations to Bobby Sladke, who retires from the Old Brick Gardens officially on June 30th. Becky Steinhoff was pictured and quoted in the feature story titled Accessing Higher Education, SPL Legacy Foundations. Thank you. Before we move on to today's program, I would like to give you a little bit of background about my Rotary journey and what you can expect from me during the evolving aspects of our year together. All right, my name is pronounced Teresa Holmes. And if you make a mistake, don't worry, your president will probably lead the way from the podium. However, I am the oldest of three children, born to a mother who worked in various areas of law enforcement and a father who served in the Navy. Over the years, I've tried to make it a habit of asking for what I need. So if it sounds a little bit like I'm telling you instead, please don't take it personally. Giving instructions is in my history. I'm a native of MMoCA, and for years, I lived one block away from the core of the original site where Juneteenth Day in MMoCA is celebrated. Most of my family members are still live in MMoCA, and so my other home, is not so far away. I often refer to myself as a twice transplant to Madison, and I initially moved here in 1989 to work for what is now Alliant Energy, but moved back to Madison after only 5 years. At that time, I would have been known as a Gen Z, and my mom, who had by then transitioned into the human services field, encouraged me to follow my heart, knowing that I had aspirations for changing the dynamics of how users experienced working with computing professionals. By the time I was 23, I had had several experiences with initiating change within teams, systems, and corporations in the United States and in other countries through the use of my natural gift to simplify tedious processes, whether they're manual or technological. I had no idea that I'd return to Madison 20 years later after creating my own firm, now Exponential Endeavors. I lead a team of solution architects who have backgrounds in either engineering, technology, or creative arts, and who are identifying efficient and innovative ways to transform technology engagements. I can speak tech English, folks. Right before the pandemic, I was asked to utilize my business model to assist a company right here in Madison with rapid redesign of its entire technology infrastructure. And because of the need to pivot quickly when the stay-at-home order went into effect in March of last year, my team and I were able to do the same for companies locally and throughout the Midwest while leading them into resiliency through the entire COVID year. So change and doing things sooner than initially planned is in my lane. Did you know that I was actually supposed to be your president next year? My Rotary journey began only 5 years ago in May of 2016 after being invited to attend a scholarship luncheon right here in this room by then Rotarian Derek Van Mills. I had been asked to join the organization before but declined because of what I believed was not present in the room. Attending one luncheon can make all the difference. And after seeing the scholarships awarded to 25 local students, I said yes without hesitancy. Service is a part of my DNA, and I come from a long line of Wisconsin and Texan public servants, and prior to that experience, lacked the awareness I now have about the Rotary Club of Madison. My first year as a Rotarian, I attended the international convention that was held in Atlanta, Georgia. Some of you were right there with me, and couldn't believe what Rotarians were doing locally and internationally. And so I have dug in my heels since then to connect, grow, and serve wherever I've been led or asked to do so. I'm a person with a deep sense of faith and believe the ability to dream and live well throughout the process of evolving circumstances is possible. A few of you have cautioned me not to use the podium as my pulpit before me. The accelerated transition to VP caused me to get to know many of you in ways I have really enjoyed, while also growing in the understanding of the traditions of this club and Rotary International. I'm looking forward to spending time with many of you while walking, dining, at local activities that combine the two, or a fellowship or community event. As we serve, the evolving aspect of changes we'll all be affected by and journey through are not intended to harm or hinder our organization from continued success and service, rather meant to create more continuity within the organization while better positioning our service teams, the committees, to execute their creative ideas throughout our club and this community. The ideas presented and approved by leaders within this club are meant to be seen and experienced far beyond a single term of the presidency. So our club's VP, Paul Hoffman, I saw him, there he is, and others who will follow him will carry that torch of ideas forward and brightly. Throughout the year, I'll lead the way in communicating and navigating the various aspects of how we'll enhance what we're doing. Being president of our club wasn't what I thought I'd be doing at the end of my board term. But as I reflect while dreaming, I realize it has become an extended part of my journey of service above self. I'm honored and humbled to serve as our club president. Thank you for such an opportunity, and now on to the rest of our program. All right, just before I introduce Rob Vanderbilt, who's going to introduce our speaker, I just want to give a little bit of a highlight about the mic. So just a few points about the mic. So because it's important to keep the Q&A going, and the member of the program committee will be holding the mic, and we have asked that person to hold the mic and keep it in their hand and not turn it over to the Rotarians. Just to keep the flow of the Q&A going, people. If a person from the floor asks a question or starts going on the tangent to make a comment, the person who has the mic will just say, I just need you to move on. So don't take it personally. We're just trying to keep the flow of the questions going, right? Lastly, if someone asks a question from the floor without the mic in the hand, the person who's holding the mic will just ask them to hold or wait until the mic gets there. Okay? All right. Now, we held our first monthly board meeting of the year on July 1st, and our thanks to Londa Dewey for providing us with meeting space at QTI. I encourage members to review our board minutes that we post in the member login tab of our club's website. We want members to see our current board members, who they are, so we ask one board member to introduce a speaker each month. This month, Rob Vandenberg will make the introduction. Rob joined our Rotary Club in 2016. Now retired, he is a former senior director of business development and engineering at Kraft Foods. Rob is just beginning his two-year term on our board, and I'll turn the mic over to Rob to introduce today's speaker.
Thanks, President Teresa. Our speaker today is Christina Brungardt, who was recently appointed the Gabriele Haberland Director of the Madison Museum of Art. She comes to us from Houston, Texas, where she served as Deputy Director of Contemporary Arts Museum, Houston. Throughout her career, Christina has served in a variety of capacities in the arts, including working for galleries in New York and Texas and teaching. Today, Christina is going to talk to us about the transformative experiences and the museum. The core of the Madison Museum of Arts and many arts organizations is to provide transformative experiences that educate, inspire, and reflect on our contemporary world. We look forward to your presentation, Christina, and we have made a contribution to the Rotary International Polio Plus Fund as a way to say thanks for speaking to us today. And I want also to mention that we will have a Q&A with our speaker at the end as time allows, but please wait for the microphone if you have a question. Let's welcome Christina Brungardt to our podium.
Hello, everyone. How are you? I got my timer with me, just in case. Though I'm a little nervous hearing about how festive the Q&A can become. So I would like to extend my sincere gratitude. Thank you so much for making a donation. And also thank you, can you hear me okay? Thank you so much for inviting me here today. I really appreciate the opportunity because I'm sure I have not met many of you in person, but perhaps through Zoom, because in the last 15 months after moving here, there hasn't been an opportunity to be in person. So this is an exciting opportunity just for me to get to know you and for you to get to know me as well. I need to find my clicker. So when I was invited to come in today, I was asked to share a little bit about myself, my vision for MMoCA, and what's happening in the museum field in general. And I will say I was a little daunted by the task because that's quite a lot going on. And also, I am a little out of practice. I haven't done a presentation in front of this large of a group in a while. So it's going to be a fun time. So for those who I have not met yet, there's my press release picture from when I was hired. I started at MMoCA in August 2020, and weirdly, it's not the same black jacket. I just have about six black suits. I realized that. Prior to that, I was at the Contemporary Arts Museum, Houston, where I served as the interim director and the deputy director. And it was during a great period of transition for the organization. So one of the things I was serving in that organization as both deputy and interim is a change agent, helping them get through periods of transition and also periods of crisis. In Houston, they experienced two, and some people will say three, financial crises in the last few years due to the oil and gas industry. We also went through Hurricane Harvey, which totally decimated the city on many levels. And we also were dealing with the first stages of the pandemic while I was there. And I was engaged in a major capital campaign construction project, so it was considered essential labor for the first wave of the pandemic in Houston. It's been a very interesting time working with museums and nonprofits, but one of the things that dealing with all of these unique experiences and moments in the last few years has taught me is that nonprofits need to move strategically. They need to think nimbly, and the most important thing is to forefront fiscal management while balancing it with their critical mission needs. So that's one of the things that I want to talk to you about today, but also just to let you know a little bit about me. I also worked in museums, I've worked in galleries. I worked for Neue Gallery New York. If ever you go, I highly recommend visiting the cafe, fantastic. And I focused my graduate studies on the nexus between art and politics. So I'll talk a little bit more about that. But if you really want to know about the core of me, this is the core.
These lovely folks are my grandparents out in western Kansas on their farm with their three oldest children and their Sunday finest. And I spent a lot of time with them growing up. My parents worked full time. And my grandfather would often take me out with him when he'd go on harvest. He didn't really say a whole lot. In fact, if you could get a word out of him, awesome. If you could get a sentence out of him, it was a red letter day. You probably warranted some sort of special treat to that day. So what he exemplified the Great Depression and the Dust Bowl. And they didn't say a whole lot. They had experienced a lot of trauma. But one thing that they taught me was quiet power. The fact that when you are quiet and you sit and you think and you reflect, you are a very powerful person when you then move into action. And so I often will think about how that became a very transformative moment for me and a transformative moment for thinking about how to act in the world. It's not so much about what you say, but what you do that matters. So somehow that weirdly led to me studying this, art and politics, which when people ask me what I study, I'm always a little hesitant to tell them I don't really study traditional paintings or sculpture. I study artists as visionaries and activists, artists who think about how to change the world, how they think about how we think about the world, and how they can motivate us to change. So on the far left is Alita, Queen of Mars, one of my favorite films of all time, Russian cinema at its finest. And the nuts and bolts of the story is that communism goes to Mars. So it's entertaining watch, but several artists worked on this, and they were looking at the film itself and as a moment of change. How do you think differently about the world? People had not seen communism in action before, so they were envisioning a different world, and they thought taking it to Mars was the place to go because things can happen on Mars. The other thing that's really beautiful in this film is this key moment where an engineer artist looks into a poster of an upcoming movie, and he sees a new world. And that's what artists do. They see a new world for us. In the center, you've got Herbert Baer, who is for the Bauhaus. He also came. We are automatically impacted by the things that we see and we do. As an artist, you do not need to make art. And you can impact people as they see space. And the last one is actually my true wheelhouse. This is Giuseppe Taranni, Sala O, from the Mostra della Rivoluzione Fascista, which is the exhibition of the fascist revolution. It's about the idea that artists can motivate to political activity. And actually, some of this is very subversive against fascism, which is also an interesting leitmotif in my studies. So when I think about this and why I came to MMoCA, I'm interested, and I thought this was a really good linking image, about how contemporary artists do this. How can they change the way we see the world? How can they transform our experiences? And what can museums and museum professionals do to facilitate that transformation? So I really liked this image. It's by a Milwaukee-based artist, Sonia Thompson, and it was installed at MMoCA. There's a lot of cohesion between the images I just showed you, and weirdly, it was happenstance that I had this moment when I was looking on the website, when I was looking at the job, and I was like, they're expanding the field of vision. And that is a miraculous thing to think about. How do you expand that field of vision? How do you think differently about the world? And that's what the museum is for. So, most importantly, looking at MMoCA's mission, the key part of it, somebody from Madison is calling me right now, the key part of it is that the transformative experiences that educate, reflect, and inspire us as individuals in a community. And so the funny thing about this mission at MMoCA is it's not unique. If you look at arts organizations all over the United States, to transform is part of who they are. It's something that's really significant in all of their missions. But what does that mean to communities? And how is it different at MMoCA? How do we make sure that we are helping artists do the work that they do? How do they enter the future? And how are we envisioning ourselves as a community in the future? And honestly, after the last 15 months, this is incredibly important. It's a great question to be asking ourselves. And I'm a firm believer that artists can point the way. They are visionaries. They see the future. So when I looked through all these different ways of thinking of transformation, I thought I'd share a personal experience of transformation in a museum space. I've had many, but I went with a recent one that I thought was particularly interesting. I was at the 57th edition of the Carnegie International. It's in Pittsburgh. And I stumbled upon this piece. And I thought, mind is completely blown by this. So if you've ever been there, it's a very classic historical building. And the piece was actually detritus and sand and different parts of Pittsburgh that were brought into the museum and carefully arranged. And it's really important to know who post-commodity is. They are as a shared indigenous lens and voice in individual actions. Their work is all about transformation, about bringing information to the public that you may not know, bringing histories that may be hidden or unseen. So this piece is transformative on so many levels. When you walk through it, it's a large place. You experience it differently. Your body feels it differently. It was also programmed with jazz music from local musicians from Pittsburgh. And it's bringing into light for people the history of Black migration into Pittsburgh, the history of industry, and the history of the indigenous peoples there. It is performed. You hear music as you walk through it. And it's one of the things that I think is really a transformative moment when you walk into a museum. You see artists telling you something you did not know. They share a vision. They share something different with you. So this piece, when I stood in front of it, I honestly just couldn't leave the room for a while because I could not stop feeling that transformation. And that's what brought me back to MMoCA. What is so significant about MMoCA's mission? What is it that we need to focus on, especially after the last 15 months? What is it that the arts do for us? And I broke it down to the four key pieces of that mission: reflect, inspire, educate, and community. And in a time when you're thinking strategically about how you use your limited funds as a nonprofit, because I think everyone here probably knows nonprofits have had a hard year, those are your mission critical items. And I like mission critical because I did live in Houston for a while. You have to always think, do we answer those four questions with every single thing we do? And then we expand it out further to the vision. Are we exchanging ideas? Are we supporting artists? Are we supporting vision? Are we creating dialogues with the world around us? And that's incredibly important to think about as you show art. So one of the things we did, and we took the time as an organization to think about, what are we doing? Who are we? It was good for me because I was new to the organization. I could spend the last few months really looking at the organization and thinking about it. So one of the things is they had an existing idea committee, inclusion, diversity, equity, accessibility, and inclusion. And we thought about how is that working? What are we doing? What are our blind spots? What do we need to think about more? We also did an American Alliance of Museums survey. We looked at what the community thought about us. We also did a collection survey. We looked at everything that's in our collection and what does it say about us as an arts institution. And we did all the analysis on that. We looked at our outreach programs. Who were we reaching? Are we actually reaching the people we think we're reaching? We looked at our programs and partnerships. Are the partnerships really true partnerships? Are they really advancing the mission? Are we getting led astray in our mission? We looked at every single document, protocol, and procedure. It's been fun. But again, every single piece that an organization produces is important to the mission. And always remembering that is key. But the thing that's most important is that doesn't stop. Every time we do something, we look at it again and we review it again. And I always make sure I get my eyes on it because, quite frankly, we need to look. We need to look closely. We need to expand our field of vision every single time we come together as an organization. So how did this play out in the last year? Because I know some of you have been down to MMoCA and some of you haven't. We started thinking about how we can leverage our resources to really focus on community and these key pieces of the organization. One of the first things we launched was a wellness program online so that we could support our community. And one of the things that was very beautiful about it is it's a way to reach people and educate, inspire, and reflect in your own life. I encourage everyone to go and enjoy this. We still have this up and running. You sit and engage with artwork at home, and you can have a guided meditation through the artwork. It brings peace and calm. It changes the way you think about art. Do you dance from home? And it's actually really important to think about how you experience art from home because it is supposed to be a moment of calm and reflection in our world. We also looked at our front space. So when the boards came down on State Street, we suddenly realized we're going to have no presence there. Those boards were so inspirational to the city. So one of our curators, Lisa Shoshone Anderson, hustled. There was no other way to describe it. She hustled, and she went out, and she found an artist whose work is specifically about protest, specifically about talking to the community, and is designed to be in windows facing out to the community. Again, forefronting community and reflecting back on our current times, thinking about how we can educate people about what is going on in our world around us. So with Patrick Martinez, it also started to expand us out. He's in LA, but he's having a conversation that we're having here in Madison, and we're having in New York, and we're having in London, and we're having in Berlin. And so it's this moment of how are we creating these dialogues across time and space? Because to me, that's the most exciting thing about what a contemporary artist is doing. They're thinking about the future. And the best part for me is he started thinking about doing this when he was a young man, when he first started attending protests. And I hope you've been downtown, and I know many people in this room. Thank you so much. I'm looking at a couple of you right now. Participated a year ago in Chicago. It opened on Juneteenth. The first phase, community leaders responded to their role and what they can do to help eradicate racism. The second phase is now public. You can come to the museum, you can fill out a ribbon, and you can also reflect on your own role in racism. You can also think about what your mantras are for the future, for change. I think the most beautiful part about the interview with Nick and Bob about this is that they said that one moment of personal reflection is where change starts. And again, that's where I find museums transformational. We provide the opportunity for the artist to share that vision. That is a vision that I think is so beautiful and something that resonated so much with what my grandfather taught me of quiet reflection, quiet power, that moment that you can change and that everyone is part of this artwork and that process. The third phase will launch later, and that will involve empowering and supporting local artists of color who will come in and respond. And we will seed the space again. So it becomes this idea of how do we always, always, always think? Does it educate, inspire, reflect, and focus on community? We have another program coming up soon. Faisal Abdullah will be doing a counter monument that will be for the public on State Street. It will be in conversation with the city. I'm not going to give too many details because I want you to come to the museum and enjoy it. It should be available for view in August, assuming we get all of our city permitting in order. Anybody who's enjoyed city permitting knows what I'm talking about. We've looked at our partnerships. So because we've been online, we've been thinking, how do we work with different partners? Some people needed space. They didn't have anywhere to go. So they came to the museum and they used our space. So this is a piece through Madison Ballet, Lift Every Voice, featuring artists. It's a beautiful series. Definitely visit the Madison Ballet's website to really focus on the idea of all the arts. So you probably have noticed we've had strange and unusual art happening, art that's about vision, activism. And we also want to think about how we bring that other piece of our vision. How do we support our cultural arts community? Which means we have to expand beyond the museum walls. We have to think about how we support artists around us. So we're doing a lot of fostering of exchange of ideas. And we will be launching this weekend a wonderful performance piece with a collective that's from around the world called Transitory Sound and Movement Collective. We've got Li Chao-Ping also on our website right now with her collective. It's about supporting them, creating moments for artists here so that there is a really vibrant cultural economy that happens in this city. Because we are a powerful city that can really bring change and think differently about changing vision. We can transform. But something that's probably more significant about what we're thinking for other voices. How do we step back? So we are stepping back for museum professionals. We want to expand our field. I'm sure you've read about how the arts have been pretty much very dominated by a white majority. And we're not seeing other visions, and we're not seeing other voices. So one of the things that we're thinking about is how do we change our model as a museum? So one of the things we're doing is we're launching a guest curator program. And we're doing that with our most signature exhibition, the Triennial. It is the most loved exhibition of all of our exhibition series at MMoCA. For 40 years, it has been curated by curators and the director, and quite frankly, I do not know anything about Wisconsin art yet because I have been locked in my house for 15 months and the museum. So we are opening it up and we should soon be able to announce who has been selected as the curator of that exhibition. But I think the most significant thing and the thing I'm most proud of for our organization during the pandemic is the launching of our new teen forum. We are opening it up for the future of the organization and the future of the field by looking to the most important people, our youth. Our teens are the ones who are really going to transform the world, and we need to give them the power to think that they have that ability. Seeing what you are doing as this organization with mentorship and supporting teens is beautiful. And it's how we change. It's how we expand the field and who is in the field. We're really excited that this group will continue. There have been amazing studies, like Room to Rise, about what teen forums can do. They are always our future art leaders. And so we are looking about how we continue to grow those future art leaders. So this is our freshman class. We're going to be expanding it even further next year, and we're going to empower our teens to hire the next class. It's going to be a fun way to get them to realize you too have a voice and power. You too determine who the field is. It's not my job. It's my job to help you. But it's all of our jobs to help with changing. So one of the things that I really just want to focus on last before I hopefully run out of time for a very frightening Q&A from what I'm gathering is thinking about how we get to true transformation and expanded vision. You can look to others and you can look to yourself, but really thinking about how I think about my life, about what I can do and what power I have. And I think about the museum. And probably because I was an educator for so many years, I realized you just have to work to give the skills and the platform and the voice and the space to others to help with that transformation. And that's what's so magical about artist activists, is that's what they're focused on. And that's why I'm so interested in how they can do that with MMoCA and with Madison, and how we can get beyond the walls of the museum. So I want to thank you all for your time. I see I'm right at my limit. But I open it up to questions, and I'm a little scared.
I have a question for you. Yeah. Will you join our club?
Oh. I appreciate the immediate question. Can I think about it and learn a little bit more about you? Will you tell me more about you?
Good.
Excellent.
Good.
I know Teresa will tell me a lot about it. Thank you for asking. You should always ask.
Hi. Welcome to Madison and It's Great Outdoors.
Yes. I
am obsessive, possibly unhealthily so, about building teams and finding solutions for climate change.
Yes. Wonderful.
Which is intensely political with a small p because it involves motivating people.
Yes.
How can your museum, which I sometimes struggle with, provide inspiration and hope for me?
I am actually really happy that you're engaged in thinking about issues of activism, climate change, and what we're doing to our environment. He has this wonderful program called the Fundred Project. He's hoping to archive it at the end of this because it's tied to pushing through a clean water bill. And he's thinking about how we change those things in our own world. And he also is working with teens to activate them into thinking what role that they have and what voice they have in change. He's also looking at migratory patterns of birds and how that's impacting our environment is impacting them. So I'm really interested, and in fact, one of my favorite areas is the nexus between art and science as a political field, because in art, you can use it as an area where you can talk about ethics through aesthetics. And it's sometimes still safer for people. So I am very, very interested, actually, in talking with you more about this.
Your presentation and the energy that you're bringing to the museum. One of the things we have missed, and I'm sure you've been aware of it even though you weren't here, is the Madison Gallery Night that's held twice a year that features not only the local artists, but the local galleries that are are inspiring art in the community. So when are we going to start again?
Well, that's also a good question. Everyone has good questions. I appreciate it. It's a good question because one of the things that effort for us, and then Art Fair on the Square, which is normally in July, had to be pushed to September. So we're trying to find space and time to do the next gallery night. That's the biggest issue. It's not that it's going away. It's that we need to figure out when you reconfigure the schedule, because usually the fall one is right around when our rescheduled art fair is. So we're going to have to push, but we hope to make announcements about that soon. It may have to be in the spring, though, but we are looking at that. And we do know it's a wonderful thing, and I've been invited to gallery night in Milwaukee, which is coming up.
Thank you for being here today. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about opportunities for collaboration with the Chazen, the
yes.
university's art department, mm-hmm. so we create some synergies for our community.
Yes, we have lots of collaboration. In fact, we just had an exhibition that was a collaboration with UW-Madison's Design Thinking for Exhibitions with Anna Campbell. The Michelle Handelman exhibition is with them. We also are looking at different collaborations across departments in different ways, I guess you could say, looking more expansively beyond the art department, but in other departments on campus. The exhibition with Faisal Abdulallah, he is a professor with the art department, so we have a plan of action behind that as well. But we are definitely actively seeking out partnerships across the city, including UW and the Chazen. And then I do talk with Amy Gilman, who is an amazing, amazing thought leader in the community, and she and I have talked about doing a perhaps partnership on a panel at some point with Faisal's exhibition. So yes.
Welcome to Madison, a little late, but we're delighted to have you here and all of your energy. The first question sounds a little impertinent, but I really want to know. Mm-hmm. As part of the change, we're going to change the pronunciation from MMoCA to MMoCA.
Well, I have heard that's a highly contentious debate. And I am familiar with this debate because where I worked before, Contemporary Arts Museum Houston, you could tell some people said CAM, some people said CAM-H, some people refused to call it CAM in general. Some people denied that the H at the end of it existed because they were the first Contemporary Arts Museum, and Houston having to be added later made them very angry. So I will give you a funny story. I was very confused when I was interviewing because one person said MMoCA, one person said MMoCA, and then other people just avoided it. So I know.
you sure you're not a politician? The last question is, I'm very actively involved with the Wisconsin Historical Society, and our mission in public mm-hmm. history is to yes. expand the audience.
Yes.
Now, mm-hmm. all of this mm-hmm. futuristic and mm-hmm. probing and intellectual mm-hmm. fervor, which I hear in your presentation and I see in the mm-hmm. slides, it's a little like jazz. It's a cultivated taste. Mm-hmm. How are you planning on opening yes. to people who are afraid of museums, never been in a museum,
yes.
and how can we make mm-hmm. this a museum for everyone?
I appreciate that. So one of the parts of my background is I used to teach at a variety of universities, and one of the experiences I had was I know, and I also know for myself, people don't feel comfortable in museums. They just don't. They, especially contemporary art, number one is being free and staying free. That is important because if there is no barrier to coming in, step one. Step two, we're also taking off admissions on things like our openings. We want to make sure it's open to everyone. We're also working with ArtCart so that we create better community reach of what's in the museum to what's out in the community and making sure that people feel comfortable and have that sense of ownership, like they're hanging out with their kids in the park, but the next thing that ever happened is the textbook was based on all museum exhibitions that were going on and had permanent collection works. So when I take my students, often who have never, ever been to a museum, they would feel that they owned the museum when they walked in. And that is something that's really important. We're also working with bringing in some artists who have a more educational component to them. We're going to be doing a show with Wendy Redstar next year, bringing it from Massachusetts MoCA. And she specifically works with kids and has more of a kid-friendly component to open up the space. We're also trying to think about how we partner to bring in more families and also, more importantly, getting out of the museum. We need to get out because to bring somebody in and feel comfortable, you have to get out of those walls first because it's an imposing space. I mean, it's a beautiful, beautiful building. but it's a scary building at the same time. When you walk in, I tracked it when I first went in. You got to walk through two doors, which I understand is Wisconsin. Most other states, you don't have two doors before you walk in. Then you have to walk about 30 feet to go to a front desk. Then you have to go up those stairs that, honestly, they're a little vertigo-inducing at times. It is a challenge. It is very much a challenge to feel welcome. So to push out and also bring people in, and I feel like they're coming to get me. But I'm happy to answer questions afterwards.
All right, I have one last announcement before we adjourn. Remember, you can register. Most recent feature that we've added to the reservations, you can now, Jason? Yes! You can text your registration to the office. All right, so just a reminder, if you would please register before the meeting occurs for the luncheons. And with that, we thank you again, Christina. We are adjourned.